And claim the limelight. Give her a hand.
Thank you.
weeks ago and asked to read is Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. They will be asked a question tonight based on that book. They will have had 30 minutes to prepare their response. Son of Susan Phelps, he wants to give a shout out to Joe Dreves. Way to be here, Joe. Right, come on down.
Withered and no birds sing. This line repeats how Rachel Carson opens her book, Silent Spring. The Silent Spring she discusses is an ecological disaster where America faces the destruction of its natural resources. She opens the book with A Fable of Tomorrow, a description of a small town in America that was once populated by birds, fish, wildlife that sang and populated with forests. And then she describes that city and that town decays as it deadens and turns into a brown wasteland where no birds sing in the summer and the spring. This is the silent spring that she is talking about, a destruction of our natural resources as a result of the increased usage of pesticides and insecticides in America. When she published her book in 1963, it was an incredibly popular book and spurned an environmental reaction caused the change the face of America. And in order to understand why this change happened, we have to understand the social and political climate of the 1960s, and also why insecticides caused such a reaction, and why people wanted to prevent the silent spring from happening. So, in her book, she describes the DDT and other pesticides as compounding throughout the environment, starting in insects that they're intended for, and building up their way up the food chain, destroying everything from fish and birds, and eventually reaching their way up to humans. Now, where did DDT and other insecticides come from? That goes back to the post-war environment in America. DDT was first used as an insecticide in the early 1900s. In fact, the man who first discovered it as an insecticide was giving the Nobel Prize. It was seen as a way to prevent the spread of malaria by stopping mosquitoes. It was incredibly successful in the Pacific War on islands in the Pacific where it could be used to help soldiers prevent malaria. And after the war, it began being mass industrialized and produced in order to be used here on the domestic front. It was seen as widely popular and it was a thing to help us. It was being sprayed on school children. Rachel Carson describes in the book that kids had little squirt guns that shoot DDT in order to both clean the house and themselves. It was being coded on people. It was seen as a good thing. And Rachel Carson's book describes how this thing that we perceive as helping us and provided to us by the government is this more sinister thing that is slowly poisoning ourselves and our water streams. This, in the context of the 1960s, is important. The 60s are a mass social change. We have a distrust in the government already. This is compounded by things like the Vietnam War, the proliferation of nuclear missiles. People are angry. They want to see change. And Rachel Carson provides an outlet for that and caused the environmental movement we know today. In 1963, when she published Silent Spring, she received massive backlash from various chemical corporations and even the U.S. Department of Agriculture. They saw her as a bunny-loving hippie who didn't have anything to say and was frankly hysterical. Our own Secretary of Agriculture called for a communist. She, however, predicted this reaction. Prior to the book's publication, she distributed the book to very prolific figures in politics and in science in order to have backers once it was published to the general public. One of these backers was our own president, JFK. Kennedy created a presidential investigative committee to investigate Ms. Carson's findings and determine whether they were true or not. And in 1963, she testified in front of Congress. The result was that Mrs. Carson was, in fact, telling the truth, and that insecticides were threatening. The environmental movement continued to build up in the 1960s, and eventually in 1970, we had the creation of the Environmental Protection Agency by Richard Nixon. In the 1970s, we see various acts that ban the use of DDT and pesticides. And the 70s are really the fruition of all this. This is where this all comes together and results in the ban of these products. In 2001, the Stockholm Conference banned DDT internationally by the UN decree. And it has to do with this social climate that people were scared. It's very much like the Romanticism, a period of the 1880s, where people, spurned by books like Henry David Thoreau's Walden Pond, wanted to see environmental change. And just like this, Rachel Carson's Silent Spring spurned this change. The fear that one day you may wake up and find that what you had once loved, the sounds of the birds singing in the spring, would be gone. Thank you.
Judges, ready? Silent Spring by Rachel Carson is considered by many to be the book to kickstart the environmental movement in America. It allowed for the United States government to realize the dangers of DDT, along with organic phosphorus insecticides, the use of which dates back to the 30s, 40s, and 50s, when Swiss scientist Paul Hermann Müller noticed its use as a potent killer. The power DDT and other pesticides possessed was, as the title of Carson's novel would suggest, something extraordinary, something that could cause a silent spring. In Chapter 1, A Fable for Tomorrow, Carson paints a typical, wholesome American town where, quote, all life seemed to live in harmony with its surroundings. Trees line the roads and life is good, that is, until birds start dying, and those that didn't trembled violently and could not fly. This was the start of a man-made silent spring, a season that, while normally filled with the chirping of baby birds and the scent of lilac, would no longer hold any of that. Instead, it would be replaced with what can only be described as a terrible emptiness, void of all life. In the following chapters, Carson goes to point out that this future is avoidable, as it would be entirely man-made. She proceeds to warn of DDT, Parathion, Malathion, and Aldrin, along with other often-used pesticides. She tells us of a, quote, year-old child taken by his American parents to Venezuela. There were cockroaches in the house to which they moved, and after a few days, a spray containing Endrin was used. From there, she tells us of the baby, along with the family dog, vomiting and suffering violent convulsions before met with death, which at that point was surely a salvation. Stories like this, along with statistics such as one showing that a man's, quote, purebred Guernsey cows after being in the way of a drifting spray of DDT, had milk containing the chemical in the amount of 14 parts per million, which is definitely too much. Individuals around that time that had even had no exposure to DDT and often had around 5.3 parts per million at this time. All of this, at the time controversial data, led to the American government and its people to think, did they really want this silent spring to become a reality? Now, despite the criticism Carson faced, even being called a communist by the US Secretary of Agriculture, people paid attention. They didn't want dead birds. They didn't want their children to face horrible deaths. The idea of a silent spring was truly a terrifying one. And thanks to the majority, and thanks majorly to Carson's book, major steps were made to prevent it. In 1968, Hungary banned use of DDT. In 1970, Norway and Sweden followed suit. Then, Germany and the US did in 1972. Now it's only known to be used in India and North Korea. In addition to wildlife preservation, seeing this as well as the elimination of DDT, years following Silent Spring's publication, environmental success rose throughout the world. They realized that we only have one Earth, and we might as well protect it. And that legacy has survived to this day. Thank you.
Solomon, come on over.
Thank you. spring is a time for birth, of birth for nature. Hibernating animals wake up from their slumber. The birds come out to sing their song, and flowers start blooming. However, there is a hidden enemy threatening this life. It's us. Pollution took off during the Industrial Revolution, when factories were built and started producing smog and dumping waste into rivers. Air pollution became so bad that you could see it in the air above cities and catch rivers on fire. And that pollution is hard in one obvious ways. But Carson explained a different kind of pollution that is much more subtle. Pesticides, or as Carson says, they should be called biocides, since they destroy, kill all life, not just the pests we aim them at. One man reached into a barrel of pesticide and to retrieve something that he dropped in, and then washed his arm off. But so much of the pesticide had seeped through his skin that he ended up dying from it. And also, when an animal survives being poisoned by a pesticide, that poison is stored in its body and is passed on to the animals that eat it. And so it moves up the food chain and throughout an ecosystem. And studies have shown that at the time, individuals with no known exposure to DDT, one type of pesticide that this book exposed, the average person had 5.3 parts per million. And that's enough to cause disintegration of liver cells and inhibit an essential enzyme in the heart muscle. Carson's book, Silent Spring, brought this damage into the eye of the public and made them want to change it. 8 years after the book was written, in 1970, Earth Day was created, the Environmental Protection Agency was formed, and the Clean Air Act was passed. And then in 1972, the Clean Water Act was also passed. This book showed people what the consequences of not caring for their environment could be, and made them want to prevent a silent spring from happening. If those pesticides could kill a person, they can kill any other form of life as well. These pesticides infiltrate all parts of an environment and poison each one of them. And then, in the springtime, when life should be returning and blooming after winter, maybe it wouldn't, and that'd be a silent spring.
Our fourth and final contestant for social studies tonight is from Hidden Valley High School, a junior, Calvin Jarvis, son of Jeff and Brian Jarvis.
Is this where I stand? Okay. So, Silent Spring by Rachel Carson, a very moving, very amazing book. And that's hard to say about science books, but it's true. So, Rachel Carson in this book explains in the very beginning, first chapter, exactly why she called it Silent Spring. Silent, not just in color, as she explains, the rose sides, once so attractive, were now lying brown and withered vegetation as though swept by fire. These two were silent, deserted by all living things. Silent in color, but silent also literally. Silent is sound. What has already silenced the voice of spring in countless towns in America? This book is an attempt to explain. I think portrayed most nicely is in chapter 8, the title, And No Birds Sing. She relates how the reckless use of these insecticides, these herbicides, these poisons and toxics in the environment have silenced birds. Over increasingly large areas of the United States, spring now comes unheralded by the return of the birds, and the early mornings are strangely silent, where once they were filled with the beauty of birdsong. This sudden silencing of the song of birds, this obliteration of the color and beauty and interest they lend to our world, have come about swiftly, insidiously, and unnoticed by those whose communities are not yet affected. She quotes an Alabama woman and a Wisconsin woman. The Alabama woman said, "There was not a sound of the song of a bird. It was eerie, terrifying. What was man doing to our perfect and beautiful world?" Wisconsin woman said, "We must save our birds. Can you imagine anything so cheerless and dreary as a springtime without a robin's song?" Silence, because the beauty of nature is gone. That is what these toxins do, and that's what she explains. But silent, perhaps in another way. Silent in the way she explained to her friends when writing this book, "There would be no peace for me if I kept silent." Silent because we did not protest the destruction of our beautiful world, because we allowed it to happen. We were silent. Because of that, we received a silent spring. But the way to avoid that silent spring was this book. Because it ensured that that silent spring would be full of protests. This book launched the environmentalist movement. If anyone has watched any presidential campaign speeches, they always at least once address this topic and sometimes are wholly devoted to it. The protection and preservation of the environment. This movement may never have gotten its feet on the ground, because at this time, ecology was that little back science that no one really cared about. People cared about technology, mathematics, because they had been to the moon. That was amazing at this time. But this book brings us back to Earth, back to nature, back to what is truly beautiful around us. And it was this book that made ecology an even respectful science. The public reacted to this book strongly, and through its pressure, through the communities resisting the toxic spraying of its environment, they enacted laws. Even though it took time for this rolling stone to gain momentum, 6 years it took after the death of Rachel Carson, which was soon after the publication of her book, 6 years. But eventually, what happened was, during the presidency Lyndon Johnson, in 1970, the public established the first of every annual Earth Day, and Congress enacted the National Environmental Policy Act, which created the Environmental Protection Agency, and it banned DDT from use in the environment and insecticides in the United States. That is how to prevent a silent spring. By informing the public. And that is exactly what Rachel did. Thank you.
At this table, and I will introduce our next musician, a senior from Illinois Valley High School, Misty Rhodes, the girlfriend of John Maldonado. She will be performing on her oboe tonight a piece called La Chicontaine by Gabriel Marie. Misty. Thank you.
their work. It rains here in the winter, but we have a drop every summer, don't we? And in Oregon, it's now legal to catch the water on your roof. Not the water that hits the ground, but the water on your roof, and store it, and then irrigate it. So we gave our students data from their part of Josephine County. And they are to determine what their precipitation is. Well, they have that data, but to determine how much water they can catch, how much they can irrigate, and what size of water storage they'll need to use, and to minimize maybe that cost of storing that water. So you have a handout that has that information and some websites, and we hope that you might want to be interested in that. Or those of you who are interested might be able to use some of this data. Thanks.
It's when you take the math skills that you learn in school and actually apply them to real life problems that you see the benefit of all of those years spent learning math. So our first competitor tonight in math is a sophomore from North Valley, Mr. Jason Burry. He is the son of Marcus Burry and Lori Cutts Burry. Come on down, Jason.
I guess I'll kind of try and talk in this one while stuff's over there. Hey guys, so I was given this second summit area for my rainfall type thing. It's circled. Yeah. Basically, the first question asked me, assume that you catch 75% of the water that falls in your between October and May and catch none of the rainfall from June to September. Use your data to determine how many gallons of rainwater you would collect on the roof that covers an 1,800 square foot basement average year. So they gave me the average from October to May, which is pretty nice, is 33.83 inches. And then from there, I took 75%, pretty easy, just times it by 0.75. And I got 25.3725 inches caught annually for that season. From there, I took that and times it by 800 square foot, but in inches, so 21,600 inches cubed. Times 25.3725, which is the inches caught. And that gave me 548,045 inches squared or cubed. And then they also gave me a formula that was pretty nice. It's how many gallons are in a, how many square inches, cubic inches are per gallon, which is 231. So I took the 231 and divided the 548,045 divided by 231. Which gave me 2,372.5 gallons that were caught by the 1,800 square foot roof. And that was the answer to the problem that I got. The second problem they gave me was how many square feet of garden or lawn can be irrigated during the summer irrigation season with the rainfall you collect from the roof. So I'm using the answer that I got from the first problem to solve the second, basically. This information right here is the needs of a garden or lawn, how much they need to be irrigated in that season that was talked about. And the total per season is 29.9925 inches cubed. This was pretty simple after I already solved the other math because I already had this number of, which number is it? This number up here. Yeah, I wrote it wrong, but yeah, I had that number, and then I divided that by the average, which is needed, which is 29.9925, and that gave me 1,935.351 square feet of garden that can be irrigated. So basically, I just took the amount that I had, and then from that, I could easily just find out how much it was because of the other formula they gave me. The last question was, in order to store the water, you will make cylindrical cisterns. Each cistern is 8 feet tall, and each is no more than 12 feet in diameter. If coffee burning inside. So I had to let you time up, so I drew this picture. Sadly enough, there's not art in academic masters, so I can't be in that. But basically, it's 8 feet tall, which is, this is a cylinder, if you can't tell. 8 feet tall, and then no greater than 12 feet in diameter. And it wanted me to figure out what the minimum amount of price would be, and what, like, which amount of cisterns I could use to minimize the price for the storage of the water I have, which is the first answer I got. From that, I did this. I took each one, which is the formula for the cylinder to find the volume of it, is pi r squared times the height. The height is always 8, and then the radius is just the 6, 8, 10, 12 divided by half each. So 3, 4, 5, and 6. Pi 3 squared times 8 is 226. I'll just kind of hurry up. Pi 4 squared is 4 under 2. Pi 5 squared times 8 is 628. Pi 6 squared is 904. And then after that, I use a formula for a cubic foot into gallons, which is 7.48. So these numbers are cubic feet, and I need to transform that into gallons, so I need to times it each by 7.48. I did that over here in this area. Sorry if I've been not holding the paper under. But I did that in this area, and I got all these answers for that. The 6 foot diameter could contain 1,691 gallons. 8 foot can contain 3,008 gallons. 10 foot can contain 4,700. And 12 foot can contain 6,768. Basically, because I had 2,372.5 gallons, the cost-effective way would be 1 8-foot diameter, which is a 3,008, because that contains all the water I need, and that is $600 or $800, which is right there. And that was all the questions I gave.
Our second math contestant tonight is a junior from Hidden Valley High School, the son of Michael and Susan Woolridge, Logan Woolridge.
Assume I catch all the rainfall from October and May. Assume I catch 75% of the rainfall on my roof between October and May. And I'm trying to find how many gallons of rainwater I would collect if I had an 1,800 square foot roof. How I went about doing this was I had I added up all the rainfall from October to May, which is 31.42 inches, and I times that by 3 over 4, which is essentially 75%, get 23.565 inches cubed. I then took that number and did a conversion factor, because 1,728 inches cubed is equal to 1 foot cubed. Come up with 0.013637 feet cubed. I then took that number and did a proportion, because I was given the conversion factor that 1 cubic foot equals 7.48 gallons. So I made a proportion right here, and found out that I had 103.61 gallons on my roof after I times it by 1,800 per, because that's how many cubic feet I have on my roof. The next problem was about irrigation. How many square feet of garden or lawn could be irrigated during the summer irrigation season with the rainfall you collected from the roof? For this, they gave us the toll per season needed was 29.9925 inches. And what I did first was I converted back into inches cubed, which is right here. 23,934.1 inches cubed. And then I divide that by 12 to get inches squared. And then I converted the inches squared into feet, and it turned out to be 66.5079 feet squared. Our final question was about cisterns and storing water and minimizing the expenses of storing it. We were given cisterns that were 8 feet tall but had different diameters and different prices. You can see right here. And my question is, how many cisterns of what diameters will minimize the expenses of storing my rainwater? I took the derivative of the cylinder problem, which is what the volume of a cylinder is pi r squared times h. I took the derivative of that, which is right here, and through solving, because it's equal to zero afterwards, I found that my radiuses would have to be 16 feet. And that is approximately two cisterns of 8 feet in diameter, which would be $1,600. That is all.
Our third contestant for mathematics is a senior from Illinois Valley High School, the son of Steve and Linda Bemis. His name is Brian Bemis. Come on up, Brian.
Well, it's easy to start with hello, but that's kind of generic, so this will be interesting. I don't have a picture of the problem, but since it was gone over, let's turn off here. I was given overall that for the months that I was recording, this was the, that for all the months of the rainfall, this was how much rain that fell. And then this was the amount of rain that was not caught during the months that we're not collecting rainfall, which gave this much rain collected per year, ignoring the, this is how much rain fell per year that was during the collection period. Then I converted it because it is for a roof that is 800 feet square feet. Multiplied by the change in square inches, multiplied by 12 inches squared. Otherwise, the paper is actually not on this other way. So the roof that the terrain is falling on is 1,800 square feet. I've converted it into square inches, because it's 12 inches per foot. But in order to get it squared, you have to square this conversion factor, which gives you 259 inches squared. Then I'm assuming that the rain collected in the roof over the course of a year. I'm going to go up to the end. I'm assuming that the rain collected in the roof over the years is going to be as big as it is. So the first question asks for gallons, which is a unit of volume. To find the volume, or the height of the water on the roof would be the 55.57 inches of rain per year, multiplied by the base, which is the size of the roof, which is the 259,200 inches squared, which produces 75% of that water. In order to find the percentage, you do 75 over 100, about 75%, multiply it by this pool up here. Yeah, normally I would show this paper that I work on, but crossed out, so yes, I grabbed the wrong number. This number up here and this number up here. I'm sorry. So that's how much water is collected in inches cubed off of the roof per year. And I wanted to change the gallons. The factor is 1 gallon per 231 inches cubed. Is about 46,000 gallons per year with it. Then the second problem asks for how much square feet can be covered with this water. And because this is a unit of volume, square feet is a unit of area. Volume is cubed, and so in order to get it out of the cubic root of this number. And then I squared it to get area. So that's how much square feet it should be able to cover. And then the last problem asks how many cylinders, they basically are cylinders in mathematical terms, and asks what the combination gets you. one of my cubic feet on the head. This came from another problem that I was working on.
That's
fine.
And our final math contestant tonight, a senior from Grants Pass High School, the son of his parents, whose names I did not write down, is Mason Pratt.
Hello? So I'm hoping you're all familiar with the problem at this point. Collecting rainwater as it falls all throughout Josephine County. So the problem states that 75% of the rain that actually falls between the months of October and May is able to be caught by whatever contraption they're trying to build. And it's on an area of 1,800 square feet. And there's 28.54 inches of rainfall per year that I'm able to collect. But I'm only able to collect 75% of that. So that's about 21.5 inches of rain per area unit of my rainwater collecting. So the first question is, how much rain do I actually collect in gallons? So to do that, the area of that I'm able to harvest the rainwater, converted into square inches, is 259,000 square inches of area, multiplied by the amount of water per inch that I collect, and that's 5.5 million cubic inches of water. In gallons, that comes out to be about 24,000 gallons of rainwater collected to irrigate with over the summer. So the second question is, how many square feet of land can I irrigate with that much rainwater? And it states that all the land needs about 30 inches of water over the entire summer. So in order to find that, I already have the amount of rainwater that I collected in inches up here. And I just divide that by the amount that each unit of area needs in water to get my answer for how many crops I can irrigate, I guess, in my English. it asks for the answer in square feet. So it's about 1,285, I guess, rounded square feet. And that answer does make sense because up here I have 1,800 square feet collected rainwater, and I collected a little bit less rainwater than each spot on the ground needs, so it makes sense that it should be slightly less area than how much I collect. So part three was definitely the most difficult. It said, well, you'll have to store the rainwater year-round, and my options are different size of containers that each cost different amounts. So it asks, how should I minimize the cost to myself to store that rainwater? And I went about this by just making it easy on myself, writing out the different dimensions. This goes from smallest to largest, so A is the smallest. They're all 8 feet tall, only the diameters change. So 6, 8, 10, and 12 feet in diameter. I went ahead and found the volumes of each. A is obviously the smallest because it's the skinniest, and B being the biggest. So this is how much water that needs to be stored. That number came from this amount of gallons just converted into cubic feet to make it easier on myself. And so, looking at the numbers, I realized that I would need 15 the smallest cisterns to hold all of the water, which comes out to $10,500. Because each one costs, I believe, $700. Size B, a little bit better, there's only 8 necessary at $800 each, or $6,400 total. Size C, 6 of them at $900 each, which is $5,400. And 4 of the largest ones would also do it at $1,000 each, which is $4,000. That seems to be the cheapest option. But then I realized, wait a second, that's waste because half of this last 4th one would be empty. So, you can actually do it a little bit cheaper. You can use 3 of the biggest ones and 1 of the second largest size to actually hold all of the rainwater, and that would be $3,000 plus $900 for this one extra one. And that comes up to $3,900, and that's the cheapest option that I could find to store all that rainwater.
Contestants' speeches are judged not only on the accuracy of their mathematics, but on their ability to explain that clearly to an audience, which I think is wonderful. You know that ball? No, that would be bass. My handwriting is terrible. Folk acoustic bass by Barbara Hellstrom, and he arranged it himself. Please welcome Casey Clark.
Thank you.
Here was the question the science contestants were given. First, what gas law is responsible for the behavior of the straw in the video clip? They're supposed to define the law and explain it to the audience. And finally, explain how this law is responsible for or determines the behavior of the straw in this video. Answering that question first tonight is a junior from Hidden Valley, son of Daryl and Carrie Simpson, Ms. Tanner Simpson.
Imagine a bedroom packed with dirty kindergartners after they each receive birthday cake. It would be chaotic, children bouncing and bouncing against each other in the walls. Now picture the same amount of children in a space the size of Grant's pass. They surely wouldn't bump into each other as much. This is a relationship between pressure, the bumping together of kids, and volume, the space taken up. This is known in the scientific community as Boyle's Law, where pressure times volume is always a constant if temperature remains the same. Now this may sound complicated, but it's not as bad as you think. So here we have pressure and volume, and it equals a constant. Constant meaning it's the same number. So here, if I want to keep this constant, the same number, and I want to increase the pressure, therefore the volume has to come down in order to keep this number the same. Same goes the other way. If the pressure goes down, the volume has to go up to keep this constant the same. That, in essence, is Boyle's Law. This law is responsible for the behavior in the water bottle. As the pressure is increased by squeezing the water bottle, the volume of what's inside has to decrease. The water, now under more pressure and less volume, pushes against the straw where the air is contained and causes the air inside to compress. The more pressure that is applied, the less volume and power the air molecules have inside the straw to push the weight to the top, which is why the contraction sinks to the bottom. More or less, the buoyant force of the straw is decreased by the exerted pressure of squeezing the water bottle. That's it.
Our second presenter for the science competition is a freshman, the youngest contestant tonight. His name is Quinn Collins. He is the son of Colleen Dietz and Matthew Collins, and he's from Illinois Valley High School. Welcome, Quinn Collins.
So for what gas law is this? I really hope I'm right here. I said Boyle's Law. And what Boyle's Law is, it states that gas, in this case, nitrogen and oxygen, increasing pressure when volume of the container is decreased, and vice versa, i.e. pressure and volume have a very distinct relationship, and it's also proportional. So what happened to a straw? Let me make sure it's not right after this. So what happened to a straw? Stop shining on it. Come on. There we go.
Okay, I'm happy.
Right here, sorry. Okay, so this top diagram here, you can see this may be familiar to some of you. Anytime you step on the brakes in your car, it does something like this. You have a cylinder full of fluid, in this case it's air, not fluids, and a piston. And when you step on the brakes, the piston compresses fluid, putting pressure through the brake line and stopping the car. Now this is the phenomenon at work here, gas, not fluid. And what happens when you compress this gas, the pressure goes up. Now what happened to a little straw, is this here, it might be a little straw, before pressure was applied to the outside of the bottle. Now the pressure of water in the bottle wants to go in the open bottom of the straw, but is held out by the pressure of the gases in the straw. That's why it floats at the top, full of air, which is lighter than water, so it floats. A little weight to keep it upright. However, when somebody decreases the volume of the water bottle by squeezing it, the pressure of the water in the water bottle goes up, allowing it to overcome the air pressure, compressing the air and entering the straw, which increases the density of air in the straw. But the air in the straw, in addition to the water getting in there, increasing the density of the straw itself, causing it to sink. As soon as the pressure is released from this bottle, the volume of the bottle again becomes larger, pressure increases, and the straw rises again.
The third science contestant tonight is an exchange student. He is from Spain. His host parents are Rob and Kathleen Jensen. His name is Pedro Comedera. Come on down, Pedro.
Constant that are the temperature at the and the mass of the air inside the straw that is constant because the straw is zero. So the other two magnitudes that affect the gas are pressure and volume. Those two magnitudes are joined together by Boyle's law that says that the initial pressure times the initial volume equals the final pressure times the final volume. That means that when the pressure is increased, the volume of the air has to decrease, which makes sense because the air is made of the small particles that are really far together, one from the other. So when the pressure increases, they can get closer. There are also another two laws that are not only in gases that have done it, that are the Pascal's principle and Archimedes' principle. Archimedes' principle says that anybody submerged in a fluid suffers an aqua force equal to the weight of the fluid displaced. And that means that if the density of the body is bigger than the density of the fluid in this experiment, then the body sinks, but if the density of the body is smaller, then it doesn't sink. So, when the experiment starts and the water is pressed, you add some pressure to the water. And due to Pascal's principle, that pressure is spread through all the water and in all directions equally. And that, since the water is closed, that makes that the water can go in any direction, only inside the straw, because there's only air inside the straw and the air is easily compressed. So now there's more pressure in that air, and according to Boyle's law, then the volume has to decrease. Since the volume has decreased, the density, that is mass divided by volume, goes up, and it can compress it. And if it's pressed enough, it would be bigger than the density of the water. Then the straw would sink. And in fact, at the end of the experiment, the water spreads a bit less, and the density of the air equals the density of the water, so it sits still in the middle of the water.
Our final science competitor tonight is a senior from North Valley High School, Mr. Matthew Ball.
Kind of mystifying, although I assume by now you probably have an idea of how it works. However, this can be easily explained by Boyle's Law, which states that the pressure of a gas times the volume of that gas in one state equals the same a different pressure times a different volume of that same gas. Or P1 times V1 equals P2 times V2. Or pressure of a gas times the volume of a gas equals a constant. So this it means that pressure and gas are inversely proportional to each other. As one increases, the other decreases according to the amount that the other increased. And this can be explained by a quick diagram here. And you can't see that one either. So, yeah. I'm going to assume you can get the general gist of what that says. So let's call it a balloon, and we're going to say it has a set number of particles in it, and it's under a constant temperature, and those are constants that aren't going to change. And it's at a set volume, and it's at a set pressure, okay? Now, if we increase the pressure on that space, the volume will decrease inversely proportionally. So as one increases, the other decreases, and vice versa. Now, in the video, So this law in proportion with the buoyance force can explain what's going on in the video. So in the video, we have three different states, and hopefully you can get an idea of what that says. Okay. So we have a straw here that has, I'm going to call it three particles, or a set number of particles in it. It's being exerted upon by the buoyant force of the water, which is that the force of the water pushing up on an object in it is equal to the mass of an object, or the density of an object in it. So a denser object will not float in water, and that's how boats work. So we in this situation, we have a straw set that there's air trapped within it, and the buoyant force of the water is able to push off on it because there's no extra pressure exerted on the straw. Now when the bottle is squeezed, you can see here, due to Charles' law, or no, Boyle's law, the volume of this straw slightly decreases because the pressure exerted on the bottle, and thus by the water on the straw, increases. Because the volume of the straw decreases, its density increases, so that the buoyant force exerted on it by the water is not proportionally as strong as the weight of it, and thus it'll begin to sink as that pressure increases. Trying to get an idea of what's going on through those diagrams. You can tell it all. So, in the situation when the bottle is squeezed more, the straw is shrunk, has a greater pressure exerted on it, and thus shrinks to a smaller volume. Therefore, it takes up a lesser amount of space, and has a higher density, and will sink.
a lot of stuff going on there, but it's kind of easy to understand. And then when the bottle is not squeezed, the volume, the pressure exerted on the straw is decreased and is able to expand again, and its density decreases, enabling it to float back up towards the top of the bottle. Hopefully that made sense to you. Can I get like a thumbs up on how many of you actually understood that? All right, I think we're doing pretty good then. So, I assume I get that. Everyone here gets it. So, thank you and have a good night.
And his accompanist tonight is Elizabeth Lenander. Please welcome Dima.
Thank you.
speech. They have three choices of questions to respond to about Pudd'nhead Wilson, a Mark Twain novel. Question number one. At the end of Pudd'nhead Wilson, Tom and Chambers are returned to their original social and economic positions. The former slave, who grew up as a privileged white man, is once again a slave. And the white boy, who had been switched into slavery, is a free man. Justice, it seems, has been served. But has it? Has justice really been served? And what does Mark Twain seem to say about law and justice? Option number two begins with a quote from the novel. Quote, "To all intents and purposes, Roxy was as white as anybody. But the 1/16th of her, which was black, outvoted the other 15 parts and made her a Negro. She was a slave and saleable as such. Her child was 31 parts white, and he too was a slave, and by a fiction of law and custom, a Negro." The question. Twain's novel grapples with the racism pervading 19th century America and the arbitrary nature of race identification, where others define who you are based on general custom and, quote, "a fiction of law." Discuss the ways in which Twain's novel is very modern in its understanding of race and what that means, and also the ways in which Twain is limited in his view of how race is defined. And the third option, the incidents and idiosyncrasies of Luigi and Angelo, the twins that caused quite a stir in Dawson's Landing, become plausible only if we understand them to be Siamese twins. Mark Twain exploits their potential for humor when he describes the one as a teetotaler and the other as an alcoholic. The one is an early riser and the other as one who likes to sleep in. The one is a gambler and the other as being adversely inclined to play cards. However, Luigi and Angelo serve a symbolic function in the novel insofar as they are allegorical figures, explaining this allegorical purpose of the twins. I'm sure each contestant will explain his or her choice, and if not, it will become apparent by their essays that they've written. They've got 30 minutes to prepare their response. First up tonight is a junior from Illinois Valley, the son of Mark and Katie Dwyer. Please welcome Liam Dwyer.
Hello. I've selected prompt two. Training is everything. The peach was once a bitter almond. The cauliflower is just a cabbage with a college education. From Pudd'nhead Wilson's calendar. While every character in Pudd'nhead Wilson is decidedly biased in a way appropriate to the time, Twain manages to evoke the opposite feeling in the reader by leaning the narrative in the other direction. Roxy and Tom are both absolutely certain that Tom's wickedness originates from his minuscule fraction, 1/32nd Negro heritage. The narrative, however, quickly explains that his corruption began due to his childhood. Raised a wealthy white, he was sickly and imperious, and it was explicitly stated that this owed only to a poor diet and poor discipline. He was distinct from Chambers, who was supposedly part Negro, only by the differences between the two boys' mannerisms and clothing. Twain's era saw many such situations of nearly unidentifiable differences between slave and master. And he made clear the ridiculousness of such a law, condemning one to slavery by an accident and far distant ancestry. Chambers further strengthened his point. When the two are switched back, and Tom is sold and Chambers becomes the heir, he is crippled. All his life, he's identified as purely as a Negro. Suddenly, he's thrust into so-called white society, and he's no longer welcome with the only friends he's ever known in the slaves. And he's unwelcome with the whites, for he speaks only the patois, the distinctly patois of a slave, and can neither read nor write. In this action, Twain predicted a problem that would still be facing some people today. When a form has boxes for Caucasian, African-American, and more, we just want to check if they are of mixed heritage. Twain's use of a white character who identified as black began to ask a serious question. What is race? Can someone identify as more than one? Or is it a solid social construct? Twain seems to support the idea of a continuum of race. He ridiculed the idea of being Negro due to one great-great-great-grandparent. Through subtle disdain, he implies a distaste for the entire concept, with the available alternative being a more open view of race, one which attaches meaning not to how who one's ancestors are, but more to how they comport themselves. And even the whites in the story are noted. The excessively melodramatic dialogue of the so-called nobleman lays bare the risibility of the importance they place in ancestry. The single most evident target is Judge Driscoll, who is described in such terms when he parades his ancestry before the town, that he seems like a child showing off a prized toy. Oh, look, I'm a member of the First Families of Virginia. Isn't this glorious? But it seems to be nothing. Twain's view was long before its time. As early as 1894, he recognized problems that would remain pertinent all the way to the modern age. If only Moore had shared his insight, perhaps we would have far fewer problems with such a petty issue as race and ancestry. Thank you.
Our second English contestant tonight is a senior from Grant Cass High School. The second of the DeVolt sisters we get to hear from tonight. This will be Ms. Kaylee DeVolt, also the daughter of Brian and Krista DeVolt.
Despite having grown up and in an era of, you know, complete racism, where they still have slavery, he was born, they still have slavery, and he lived, you know, through the Civil War until after, but he still saw the way that blacks were treated. And through his characters, he changes the way that they are viewed. For example, when we first meet the character Roxy, that she's portrayed as a beautiful white of color woman, despite the fact that she is 1/16th of black. And it's because of that 1/16th that she is still considered a black and a slave. And Tom kind of plays around with the idea that that is, you know, it's idiotic, because why are we judging by just their background instead of who they are? And she also displays, instead of as many people viewed the blacks back then, she's displayed as human and has very human characteristics. And she's very independent as a black woman. And she's, you know, she has a very sly mind, and she's able to manipulate white people very, very well throughout the book. And he also represents the way that black people are human through the character of Tom, or as he was born to the name Chambers, when he's changed to believe that he is white when he's growing up. And he also goes to show that just because we judge by skin color is wrong, because everyone is fooled that he is white, even though he is actually the black born son. And he is also very, very human in the way he acts, in the way that he's portrayed throughout the book. Another way that Mark Twain steps forward in his writing against racism is that, unlike a lot of abolitionist writers, he displays those black, very unlikable characters, which is uncommon among people who are trying to make the image of black people throughout the entire book. You are prone to want to like Roxy because she's a mother who's done everything for her son. You're prone to try and give Tom a chance every now and again. But over and over again, they are unlikable characters, very, very hateable throughout the book. And the way that Mark Twain was limited, however, was that he did, in fact, grow up in a racist society, and so he was stuck in the mindset that we are still thought of as races instead of just as humans of wholes, because he had the mannerisms, despite that they were black, they had these characteristics, he was held back from that. And also, it is through the characters' twins throughout the book, because they are Italian. And when Mark Twain wrote this book, he lived in Italy, and he did not like it there. So that is partly displayed through his image of the twins in the book. Mark Twain is one of those major writers that pretty much every American going through public education system knows, partly because his writing is very, very good, in my opinion, but also because of his role in the change of the way we view each other. And through this book, it is very, very evident how stupid he thinks it is that we define each other by the color of our skin and by our mannerisms, of course, and through who we are born in our language. And it also shines, like, by looking back and through his writing, we are able to look forward into how we view each other, and that helps. That's very modern of him because it's still relevant to the fact that we are still prejudiced against each other. And despite being born in a time where racism was a common thing and blacks were still slaves and considered objects to be owned, not humans and individuals. And so Mark Twain stepped out of that boundary, and instead of just being human and equals, he portrayed them as individuals, which gives them a better life than other authors of this time period.
The son of Jim and Ramona Marks, Miss Melody Marks. Daughter.
Okay. So I chose to be the first topic tonight. I was told you guys all heard that, so that's what I'm voting for. Mark Twain wrote Pudd'nhead Wilson in a time of great slavery and injustice. It was actually after the time of slavery, but he wrote it about slavery. He took these injustices and transformed them into stories that we can all relate to. Twain makes justice and law a great importance in his novel, but he does it to prove a point. That with law and our current justice system, current in his time as well, who really gets served? Both of the boys in the book are born on the same day, and surprisingly, look identical, save for their clothing. Throughout the story, the babies are switched, crimes are committed, and a man born a slave but grew up white is found to be a slave once more, while the white man, raised black, is made free. This is found in the book to be just and lawful. However, who got the happy ending in this story? That's what justice made for, correct? Certainly not those who got the happy ending. So the wrongdoer is punished, but the victim, which actually was Roxy, who got away totally free, the wrongdoer is punished, but the victim is given what was taken from him. In the case of Tom and Chambers, the two boys in the story, by righting one wrong, they commit another. The slave-born white man is sold downriver, and the white-born slave is made an outcast, not fully fitting in with his black friends, but not exactly welcome in the white world. Mark Twain does this to prove a point. He says about law and justice that neither can be successful while there is a wrongdoing being done. No justice was not served. Because the true wrongdoer, Roxy, escaped the situation free of blame, and both the innocents were made miserable. Twain compared law and justice to that of fate. Can one escape fate? Twain does not believe so. Someone once said that laws were meant to be broken. Someone else once said that justice was made to be served. With both of these ideas bouncing around in Mark Twain's head, it doesn't surprise anyone that these ideas are set up into his novel. His own ideas on law and justice are for everyone to live happily in peace, but in all of his novels, he does exactly opposite of that. A very 70s outlook, whether it's the 1870s he grew up in or the 1970s that we know. Keeping the peace seems to be the only way that everyone is happy.
Okay. Our final contestant tonight, we have saved the best for last, not that I'm biased in any way, Miss Sierra Tillery, a senior from Hidden Valley High School, the daughter of Doug and Mary Tillery, who will be joining us hopefully really soon up here in front of you.
Luigi and Angelo share a body. In Pudd'nhead Wilson, they share an identity. The twins, whether connected or separated, serve to demonstrate the individual's inability to self-determine their identity. Luigi and Angelo's personalities could not be more different if they are always characterized as a single entity. Entity. The people who know them well know them just how different they are from each other, but still consider each only half of a set. If the townspeople hadn't known them as twins before their arrival, they might not have even recognized them as brothers. Their personalities are polar opposites. Angelo is moral and good, while Luigi is hedonistic. The twins don't even truly look alike. In Those Extraordinary Twins, Luigi even mentions that despite them being conjoined, he's in fact 6 months older. I'm not quite sure how that works out, but yeah. The twins are not truly twins at all. As with any good symbolism, the twins can stand for many things. The duality of man, the role of the individual, or the ability to create your own identity. But Mark Twain makes clear with his use of the twins, his use of the twins, with his views about race. Each twin's actions are not solely his own. He is credited for and accused for what his brother does. When Luigi kicks Tom Driscoll, his brother Angelo is also accused of the crime. When it is believed one of the twins is responsible for the murder of Judge Driscoll, both are put on trial. The town's negative view of one twin turns them also against the associated one. This has also been true in matters of race. It is simply stereotyping. When people at the time would hear stories portraying a slave as a savage or a brute, they began to believe it about the whole race. They were guilty simply by association. They had nothing to do with who they were as people or their own actions. The twins cannot control their identity because theirs is a group identity. It is determined by a single characteristic, much like Roxy having 1/16 black blood. It is not a large part of them, and it does not determine if they are mean or kind or smart or dumb or any of the millions of characteristics that make us individuals. But this is how the community identifies them, and therefore how they identify themselves. Mark Twain was a political man, and he wrote this in a time when most writers portrayed slaves as brutes or idiots that needed slavery. Twain used his characters, including the twins, to show how ridiculous it was to base an identity off a single trait. Each slave was not the same, just like twins aren't the same person in two bodies. Using stereotypes and group identities takes away a person's freedom to be themselves, rather than being defined by someone's negative actions. Thank you.
I invite all of the music contestants to come up and stand center stage, and we're going to announce the winners. Come on down. It would probably be a good thing to explain that the academic master's competition is unique as far as we can tell. This is not a scholarship contest. This is a cash prize award contest. The first place winner in each category tonight will be given a check for $1,200. Alas, you don't get that check tonight, but it will come. The second place winner is $800. Third place is $500. And fourth place is $300. So that money is awarded to the contestant who gets to choose how he or she will spend it. So I'm going to announce the fourth place winner, and then the third place winner, and then the first place winner, and then the second place winner, just because that makes sense to me. So, our fourth place winner in the music competition tonight from North Valley is Casey Clark. Our third place winner for music competition tonight from Illinois Valley, Misty Rose. That leaves two contestants for the first place position. You go ahead and guess, you've got a 50-50 chance. The winner of the 2014 music competition from Hidden Valley High School, Dima Clark. So music finalists, here's the MO. You get to go sit down, don't leave the building.
Okay.
After we have granted all of the awards to everybody, we're gonna call you back here in Illinois Valley, Mr. Solomon Zook. Third place, from Hidden Valley High School, Mr. Calvin Jarvis. The first place finisher from social studies from Grants Pass High School, Ryan Chancellor. Second place from North Valley, Ellie Pitt. For the sake of redundancy, have a seat, but do not leave the building. Be ready for photographing soon to come. Have a seat. Our next category was math, you know, the one that I couldn't count to correctly when I introduced them. Well, the math contestants, Justin Burry, Logan Woolridge, Brian Bemis, and Macy Pratt. Fourth place winner for math in this year's competition from North Valley High School, Justin Burry. Our third place winner from Hidden Valley High School, Logan Woolridge. And the first place finisher from Grants Pass High School, Mason Pratt. Second place from Illinois Valley, Brian Bean. Gentlemen, what are you supposed to do?
Sit down and leave.
Don't leave.
Perfect. That's it. All right, science, come on down. Mr. Tanner Simpson, Quinn Collins, Pedro Comerera, and Matthew Ball. The English people are slow. I don't have the results yet. Scroll on up here. There you go. All righty. The fourth place award tonight for the science competition goes to North Valley High School's Matthew Ball. The third place winner for tonight's science contest from Illinois Valley High School, Mr. Quinn Collins. And the first place, the tight race that we were all clenching our knuckles for. First place finisher in science for this year is Pedro Tomeira. Gentlemen, have a seat, but don't go far. Yes, bears are ferocious. All right, the fourth place winner for the English competition this year from Grand Pass High School, Kaylee DeBolt. The third place winner from Hidden Valley High School, Sierra Tillery. Dramatic pause. You would indicate this in writing with an ellipsis. The winner of the English competition from Illinois Valley High School, congratulations. Take a seat. The other competition tonight is the participation award. As you came in, each of you was asked to cast a vote for which school you were supporting. That number is then taken as a percentage of the student body at that school to count our participation. And the winner of the participation award, bringing me immense joy for the first time ever, is Hidden Valley High School. If you were one of my comp students here supporting these kids, will you stand up? Congratulations. Second place, Hidden Valley High School. Third place, Illinois Valley High School. And fourth place, North Valley High School. Many, many thanks to the judges, to the audience for coming tonight, to the teachers and parents of all these kids. Can I have all of the 20?